I just.
You say you ran for office a couple of years
ago? Yeah, I guess Todd and I pulled out and then I helped Todd get in there.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, it's nice to meet you.
He's good.
So you're from Todd's district. You got nobody running this time.
I actually texted Todd about that. And I said, Todd, must be nice not having to do anything.
Yeah.
Said, yeah. I helped him out a lot in his election. I was going through divorce, so probably the best time. You know, just decided, hey, probably something to end up the paper.
You know Nydia, the famous Nydia Tisdale?
I know Nydia very well. Kyle Beavis.
Hello, hey, Kyle.
Yeah, I meet you a couple of times.
Welcome to night number 2 of 2012 Forsyth County Republican Party's debate series. We are pleased to welcome at our 6:30 debate Chairman Jim Boff and Mr. John Derucki. We will be beginning the debate here shortly, but as we always do in Republican Party meetings, we'd like to begin our meeting with an invocation and a pledge of allegiance. So if you would please stand as you're ready. God, we're thankful for our county, for our country, and for the rights you've given to us. We're grateful for these men and women who put their name forward to serve as public office. It's not an easy trust. It's time away from their businesses and from their families, and we're thankful for all of their willingness to do this. Give us all wisdom as a community as we select our leaders. Give our candidates wisdom and courage to do what's right. Use us as you see fit. In Christ's name, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening. My name is Ethan Underwood. I have the pleasure of serving as chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party. And this is one of the wonderful jobs I get to do is to try to work with candidates and help provide information to our electorate. Our job as the Republican Party is not to choose a candidate during the primary system, but to provide that information to the public and help them to make the best choice. With us tonight, as stated, we have Chairman Jim Boff and Mr. John Derucki. They are our candidates for Commission District 5. Please help me welcome them. The format of tonight's debate is going to be a round-robin style. The intention is to create a dialogue. Each candidate will get 2 minutes to introduce himself or herself, state why he or she is running for office, and to address issues important to that candidate. During the next phase of the debate, we will begin with questions. The questions were developed by unanimous consent of the Forsyth County Republican Party's Executive Committee, and those questions we developed are tabbed out in this little box. Even I don't know which ones I'm going to be drawing. So that's to make it fair. All the questions are candidate neutral, and the intent is to try to flesh out information. Now the candidate's jobs in answering the questions, each one will have 1 minute to answer the question, and then we'll have a minute for rebuttal. So for example, for the first question we'll start with Chairman Boff. He'll have 1 minute to answer. Mr. Derucki will then have another minute, then back to Mr. Boff for 1 minute, and back to Mr. Derucki. The intent is to be able to facilitate conversation and dialogue bouncing off of each other's answers. Our timekeeper, Mr. Joel Nine, is stationed down at the front. He'll be showing you a 1 minute and a 15 second, and you're out of time card, so please keep an eye out for him. Our rules, one, we've been asked by the staff here not to move the monitors here because of wiring problems, so please don't move the monitors. Two, each candidate is not allowed to send or text messages or receive text messages during the debate. And at the closing, each candidate will have 1.5 minutes to make their closing statement. Are you gentlemen ready to begin? Well, our first question will begin with Chairman Boff.
Intros.
Chairman Boff.
Intros.
I'm sorry.
Here, intros. Number one.
Introduction.
Introduction. Oh, excited. All right, Mr. Boff, give me your introduction, please.
Thank you. Can anybody hear this? Can anybody hear this? I only plan to stand for the introduction and maybe me. My name is Jim Boff. I've lived in Forsyth County for approximately 19 years.
I live on Lake Lanier, and before that I lived in a subdivision near Lake Lanier, near Beaufort Dam Road. I'm married and have two daughters. My wife is Cindy Boff, and we attend Coming United, First United Methodist Church. And I have always loved it here, and continue to love it here, and plan on staying here for a very, very long time, hopefully forever. I welcome you all here, and thank you for taking the time. I know it's not easy, and I know that there are other things you could be doing. But I think it's important, as you all do, that we all participate. If we don't participate, who will? I was elected chairman to the Forsyth Board of Commissioner in February of this year, and I essentially like to think of myself as someone who sees things the way that homeowners see things. I think that homeowners have been given a raw deal by both the government and in some cases businesses over the last several years. Housing values have fallen and other things have happened to unemployment. Therefore, in terms of zoning and in terms of seeing that fairness is done, I always try to ask myself how this will affect the homeowner first. The good news is that Forsyth County, and I said this when I first ran, is in pretty good shape. Financially, we're doing okay, better than others. Our housing starts, according to a report I saw today, we have about 400 to 500 housing starts so far. And I think that good government that you have had here for a while and continue to have has been helpful in that regard. I plan to continue to help and keep in that tradition, and I will certainly use your vote this time. Thank you very much.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm pretty loud, so I don't know if it's coming across this or I'm just going to project myself out there. Let me give you a little bit of background on myself, if I haven't had a chance to meet with you or speak in front of you before. As you know, my name is John Derucki. I've lived in Forsyth County since 2001. I grew up in a small town not too far from Indianapolis, where I lived until I was about 18. And I'm going to try to give you a sense of a little bit of my background so you understand how I'm a fiscal conservative. When I lived on a farm when I was young, one of the things that we had to do at the ripe age of about 13 was to bale hay. And that wasn't a time in my life where we did that to buy things that were special or fun. Those were times when we worked in the fields to buy our school clothes. So I grew up in that lifestyle until we got to the point where my parents had to move to a bigger city where they could seek employment. And I stayed there until I was about 18. And one of the things that was important to me when I turned 18, even though I had an opportunity to go to college and play football and wrestle on a scholarship, I wanted to join a fraternity that my father and my uncles belonged to. So at that time, I enlisted in the military. And that was probably one of the smartest decisions I ever made. I'm an Army veteran, I'm a father, I'm a husband, I married my high school sweetheart. This summer, shortly after the election, we'll have been married for 32 years. I'm a business owner, and in my mind, I'm living the life dream. I'm a little bit different than you folks. You're all concerned about your community. I'm concerned about my community. The only difference between you and I is the fact that I decided to get up here and run for county office, which is not a comfort zone for any of us. Trust me, this takes a lot of personal courage. So I hope you get to know a little more about me tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Joe, do you have time for questions now?
Yes, sir.
All right. Chairman Ball, what is your vision for Forsyth County in 20 years, and what do you plan to do as a commissioner to achieve that vision?
I wish I could honestly say that I can see far enough out to 20 years to make it worthwhile trying to project something. I can see something for the next 4, 5, 6 years. Forsyth County's had a lot of growth. We've had a lot of things here. We've had losses. We have loss. We have water contracts. two SPLOS actually. We've got different forms of taxation, we've got green space. Most of those things are things which are producing revenue for us now. We bought a lot of land. I think Forsyth should now take the time to develop those places, enjoy those places, spend reasonable amounts of money in operating them, but otherwise use the time that we have now to quit building things, quit acquiring new things, pay off debt, and keep taxes as low as possible. I think that is the general thing that will do us the best in the future. We have a lot of recreational facilities, not the least of which is Lake Lanier, and we should enjoy them and share them with whoever will come and help us and help pay our loss. Thank you.
Mr. Derucki, you need me to repeat the question?
No, I'm good. One of the most important things that I think that I see in the future for this county, and it has to start now, is that we develop a local government that works together for all benefit of all county residents. I know it's a little bit different because we're at that point where we're starting to vote and select our commissioners on a district basis, but at the end of the day, when we elect, no matter what district you live in, we've got to start electing commissioners that can work together, be productive, be proficient, and work for everybody in this county. That's goal number one from my perspective. We need to have quality economic development and job growth that broadens our tax base. For a long time, we've been a community of a neighborhood community, but in order to be efficient, productive, and so that you don't carry the burden solely as a homeowner, we need to broaden our tax base.
Mr. Boff, do you have anything to add to your thoughts?
I think that we're doing quite well, especially in the economic times. I don't know what's wrong with what we've done so far, and I would hope that you would agree that it's time to continue what we've done so far, with an eye towards paying down debt and keeping taxes low.
Mr. Drew?
I think a lot of the things that have come to this county, honestly, have become up to us a little bit by hard work. I'm not gonna take that away from any current commissioner or any past commissioner. There have been some good things, but I also think there's been things that we really haven't spent a sufficient amount of time on. And we need to work harder at different things. You know, I don't think that the economic development that we have, that you see currently, is that productive. I mean, take a drive through District 5 now, go from the Chattahoochee River toward downtown Cumming. What do you see? A car wash that looks like some kind of a castle, a McDonald's, a bank, and a liquor store. Is that the kind of economic development that we're capable of? I think we're more than capable of that.
This question will be led off by Mr. Derucki. What would you do to improve working relations with the City of Cumming?
Wow. You know, that is so frustrating for me personally. I honestly believe that the mayor sits over in his office, peeks out his window blinds, and says, who are they going to send over now? I mean, really, I mean, we've got to get together collectively, come up with a plan, no matter what we're negotiating with the city, whether it's a water contract or whether it's the loss that's coming up, we've got to have a collective plan that we all agree on. It's going to take some give and take, and then we have to go over there based on fact, and with fact and togetherness, you will have strength. When you don't do that and you're divided, you might as well not even cross the street.
Kevin Bob.
I think it's a shame that you started off thinking that the mayor was trying to see who was going to walk across the street rather than come across the street himself. I certainly think that I clearly pushed very hard to make the negotiations since I've been chairman with the City of Cumming open and available to the public and transparent. my other commissioners agreed with that approach, but we had a fair amount of it, at least in the beginning days of it. I think that the fair thing to do, really, is to worry more about the value that we get in our relationship with the city of Cumming than whether commissioners and these elected officials or ersatz elected officials over there get along with one another.
Mr. Derucki, do you have a follow-up response? Mr. Boff? Thank you. This next question will be started by Mr. Boff. Have you identified any areas of county government that can be made more efficient? And if so, what are they and what would you do, what do you intend to do to accomplish this improved efficiency?
I don't have any strong place where I would make things more efficient. I look for more for effectiveness, and I think that we have a fairly effective government. It's relatively balanced for the services that we provide against the revenues that we bring in. So in general, as long as things remain relatively balanced where we are, I think we are doing pretty well. We get a lot of grants. We use the grants to the full effect. And a grant, you know, might typically be something like an agency to give us 40% of the money if we come up with 60% of it. And I think that we're getting pretty good value right now from the revenues.
Mr. Derucki, have you identified any areas of county government that can be made more efficient? And if so, what are they? And what do you intend to do to accomplish this?
2 years ago, I sat on a committee with local business owners that made 38 suggestions to the county to become more efficient. When I say more efficient, I'm not talking about, you know, dropping our guard, changing building codes and overlay districts to just let the developers overrun the county. I'm talking about being more efficient. You have to understand that when a business owner wants to come here and they want to open up a business, there is a lot of time value of money that's being spent. I'll give you one quick example about it because we only get 1 minute, so we have to kind of talk fast on this. But when you come here and you try to pull a permit, you're going to go to multiple locations to try to get that done. And you're going to have to courier it between coming down to the county building, going up to the fire department, going over to the Department of Public Health. And that takes a lot of time, takes a lot of energy, takes money, and it is inefficient. I don't understand for the life of me why we can't consolidate that like a lot of other municipalities do.
Mr. Boff, you ready to vote?
Again, we've got around 500 new permits started here. Even though John doesn't like parts of Highway 20, immediately behind Highway 20 is a $50 million house that sold recently for around $10 million. Again, showing what our banking system, government, and in some cases private corporations have done to this country. But I think that we're doing okay. If we make things a little bit easier for developers, that'd be fine with me, but I don't think that most homeowners are going to go to sleep better at night saying, I sure am glad the developers are cozy here in this county.
Mr. Drew,
it's not about the developers being cozy. You know, understand that I have, you know, I'm a general contractor, and we, I don't know if this is
not,
oh, I'm sorry. It's not about developers being comfortable here. What it's about is that making it efficient for business owners when they come here. You know, as a general contractor, I have the opportunity to work with a lot of different business types who have to come here, whether you're building a corporate office space, whether you're building a tanning salon, whether you're building a little boutique. Those are the people that I'm talking about. Those are the people that do everything they can to invest their life savings in a business. And when they can't come to the county and get that done efficiently, that business is going to go somewhere else. That's important. Those are good jobs, folks.
Thank you. question is for Mr. Derucki. When do you believe it is appropriate for the commission to use the county's power of condemnation? When do you believe it is appropriate for the commission to use the county's power of condemnation?
That's a tough question. I'm a big advocate of property owners' properties and their rights that go with that. You know, I know that as a board member for Three Chimneys, that we potentially have this coming up in our subdivision. And that's going to be tough. I mean, you're talking about coming in and taking somebody's property away from them for the benefit of their use. So, to me, there would have to be some overwhelming fact-based problem that we would need to solve as a county to do that. And then to talk about the compensation for that, that's just not fair market value. That's just compensation. And how you put a figure on that and you treat everybody fairly, I would exercise that with great caution.
Chairman Roth.
Great caution does need to be used because private property is extremely important to everyone. However, there are times for the good of all, for the good of the most, that condemnations have been used and will be used. Certainly when there are situations like a road, certainly when there are situations that otherwise might not be resolvable, that is clearly for the good of the rest of us. Condemnation will happen whether I'm commissioner or not. I didn't invent the thing, I use it as lightly as I can, but it's a reality of the nature of government. Imagine if we didn't have Lake Lanier, how it would be here, and yet that's a man made lake.
Mr.
Drew,
any rebuttal? Mr. Bob, any additional questions? Chairman Boff, when do you believe commissioners should accept the recommendations of county staff regarding vendors, and when is it appropriate to not accept such recommendations? What criteria will you use in considering whether to support recommendations by county staff regarding vendors?
In general, the politicians in the room are usually the least knowledgeable about any subject, and that's the case perhaps around the world, unfortunately. It's no less true here. Staff generally has to live with the decisions that we make day to day. They generally have the expertise. They generally have the knowledge. You will find me generally agreeing with staff insofar as I can understand what their points are. You will find me disagreeing with staff or perhaps voting against staff in situations where I can see a clear advantage to something that they are not able to describe as an advantage, but I would expect it to be rare that it happens. As far as I know, it hasn't happened so far.
Mr. Drew, I'm going to repeat the question. When do you believe commissioners should accept the recommendations of county staff regarding vendors, and when is it appropriate to not accept those recommendations? What criteria will you use in considering whether to support recommendations by county staff regarding vendors?
It's important for elected officials to listen to county staff. They more than likely are the experts in the issue, but that's not always the case. You know, obviously I think that an elected official has to step in if they feel like that there are some special interest groups or people trying to inappropriately influence the decision, and unfortunately you may find that the staff is leaning that way because of the influence that would be appropriate to go against those recommendations. Depending upon what the subject matter is, it may be that a particular commissioner does have an area of expertise that can lend to the decision. I think it's important too, a lot of the times, to try to understand what was the criteria that was initially set out for that staff member to make that decision. If there were issues in how that was given to the vendors, and it was open for interpretation, and therefore you have, let's say, proposals that come in that are spread out, then there's something wrong, and that's time when the commissioner should step in and make a final decision.
Chairman Boff, any additional comment?
I'm good.
Mr. Derucki, any additional? All right, Mr. Derucki, what is Forsyth County's greatest need that you intend to address as a commissioner?
One of the troubling things to me right now is that we have approximately $300 million in long-term debt. And, you know, the more and more that I try to dive into the county's business and understand the background and read annual reports and read transportation issues, I keep coming back to that figure. And, you know, I just know how I live my life, and that by no way means is stretching myself beyond my own means. And right now, my biggest concern is that $297 million grows into $497 million or $500 million or whatever the number is, because we have the capability of going much further than that. What I'd like to do is to focus on setting up a reserve, because folks, with the growth coming, we're going to need it. We've got a lot of improvements and a lot of infrastructure issues that we need to think about.
Right. Chairman Boff.
Most of that debt is due to helping out developers, which in turn helps out all of us. But the debt comes by and large for water and sewer. There's always risk with debt. But I would say one of the least risky things to think about is whether everybody here is going to continue to use water and sewer anymore. As long as you do, you'll be paying the bill, which will pay off most of that debt. Again, and most of that debt is undertaken by the county at the desire of developers who can get more density onto their properties if there is, especially if there is water and sewer. So that's the large chunk of the reason why there is that kind of debt. With me, as I said before, I plan to enjoy the county as it is, enjoy what we have, and pay down debt to the degree that we can. I also would say, if we're in such bad shape, it's hard to justify our AAA rating.
Mr. Drew, can you follow?
Yes. Our long-term debt is broken down this way, folks. General obligation bonds payable, principal and interest in 2028 of $196.3 million. Certificate of participation, principal and interest payable, 2028, $14.2 million. Revenue bonds, principal and interest payable in 2037, $251 million. Okay, so if you read the annual report, it says that we have, at the end of 2010, $297.53 million in long-term debt. The 297 doesn't sound that huge, but when you start thinking about paying the principal and interest, then to me, that's going to make it more and more difficult for this to be a community where I feel like my young family, my young daughters can move in here without taking on that debt. I mean, you know, let's talk about that. Let's, you know, go home tonight and turn on the TV and tell me that we're not talking about debt. How are we different?
Chairman Boff.
We're different in that we, A, have to have a balanced budget, and B, have AAA bond rating. As you well know, John, Vickery Village is a very nice development because you worked on it, but Vickery Village was only possible because of the high density that was available there because of water and sewer. And again, the vast majority of this debt is tied to the water and sewer department.
Next question will be led off by Chairman Boff. Why are you a Republican, and with which Republican principles do you most identify?
Partially the answer is I'm a Republican because my parents were. Partially it's because I, through them, who were both extremely conservative, I have developed conservative habits and conservative points of view. Therefore, I would have to say, overall, the desire to spend money effectively and as little as possible for the best possible advantage and for the best possible things is the primary reason that I'm conservative beyond growing up.
Mr. Derucki?
I'm a Republican because I grew up in a town of Democrats. And honestly, I saw it destroy my community. You know, I also enlisted in the military at the ripe age of 18 years old and had the fortune to serve, but I went through the Carter era. And you know what, to see what they did in terms of defense spending and what that ultimately did to the military and how it degraded it and broke down the NCO Corps and left people almost homeless, or what you would think was homeless, and living off of food stamps, that kind of thing really disturbs me, and it drives me that much today. And that has a lot to do with why I've always been a Republican as long as I can remember.
Mr. Boff, would you like to add anything? Mr. Derucki? All right, next question, Mr. Derucki. Should any of the county departments be considered for elimination or drastic reduction? Which ones and why?
That's one of the difficulties about running against the incumbent. You don't always have access to complete information. I mean, there's things out there that I would think that we would want to consider. Again, I'm going to go back to the permitting process because I understand it and I deal with it. I see what's being done in other municipalities. Again, I always find it amazing to me that to pull a permit that, you know, you have multiple people reviewing it when they basically have the same certifications, the same backgrounds, the same education. So those kinds of processes, it would seem to me that we could eliminate or consolidate and retrain folks, and or in some cases get firemen back out on duty. That's a simple one. I think maybe, you know, outsourcing utility collections, those kinds of things would be things that we would have to take a look at.
Chairman Ball, do you need me to repeat the question?
No, that's okay. Sometimes I would like to reduce the Board of Commissioners. In general, it's my opinion that the departments that we have in the county are providing good service to everybody. There is one exception, and I know people are going to probably make this out for more than I intended to be, but some of the expenses in the Sheriff's Department seem on the high side to me, and I would hope that we can resolve why they are what they are. Either provide what he needs or come down a little bit on some of the prices there.
Mr. Derucki? Mr. Bob? Anything additional? Mr. Kirk? No, I'm sorry, this is from Mr. Bob. What criteria would you use to determine how to use the green space bond funds and how they should be spent?
What criteria? I'm sorry, Ethan, I'm not sure that I understand the question because largely we spent money on that, I think.
Okay, our understanding is there's still some money to be spent on the green space bond. Yeah. The commission has to decide how that's going to be spent. What criteria would you use to make this decision?
Well, for some of the good that it's done, in my opinion, the green space bond had some real problems with it, in that no one ever bothered to define green space. Nowhere can I find a consistent definition of what anybody, now everybody that I talk to, when you talk to them, absolutely knows what green space is until you find somebody else who disagrees. I believe, and I don't remember off the top of my head, I believe any project that we promised to the voters, or the previous commission promised to the voters in a map or some other kind of advertisement or language, We should look seriously at coming to as close to completion of that as we can. If we, in fact, we have completed all those projects, I would not be opposed to just letting some time lapse rather than run out and bond that money.
Mr. Derucki? Assuming that, you know, we have fulfilled our obligation and our promise to the voters with regard to what we have spent and the projects that have been promised, that being done and completed, I think is important. But what I'd like to see is to be able to take that money, the balance of that money, and go out and improve the existing parks that we have. I'm a big lover of the parks. You know, as a kid, I mean, quite frankly, that's all we had. We didn't go to Six Flags and all, you know, Disney World and all that. We went to the local parks, and to this day, I still do the same thing. I know that in our district, specifically, there are a couple on Wind River Parkway that I'd love to see expanded, improved, enhanced. I know that it's near and dear to the constituents in our district. At least that's what I'm hearing when I'm out walking door to door. Mr. Boff, anything additional? Mr. Derucki, would you like to add to your comments? Mr. Derucki, how do you intend to balance the Republican principle of private property rights against the regulation of development in the county?
That's a very broad question.
You got a minute?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, folks, that is a very tough question because you have to, from the way I look at it, is how do you break that down and what is that development? You know, all of us had an opportunity to speak at the Smart Growth Forum. You know, I think that there's a lot of things that we need to do to force developers or to work cooperatively with developers to get more for the county. That's an area that I don't think that we're really concentrating and focusing on. And I'll give you one example, and that's the Greenway. You know, I still find that hard to believe. And I run the Greenway all the time, how we went out and we built the Greenway when we didn't work hand-in-hand with the developers to get them to deed that property back over to the county so that we can both use it as green space. So I think we've got a lot of improvement in that area.
Mr. Bob?
First of all, property rights is at the core, I think, of that question. And we should always remember that, you know, everyone who has property has rights to that property, whether they own a single-family house or they want to do a large development. That being said, that's why we have the UDC. The UDC, as all man-made documents, is not perfect and it's subject to change, but it has been thought of as much as any other document that I know from this county. And it incorporates and codifies in advance for anybody who cares to read it, and believe me, developers care to read it, kind of the rules, the outcomes, the qualities that we are looking for when a developer comes here. And so, as before when I ran, reasonable conformance to the UDC will be my guide to what we do on these issues.
Mr. Rudy, you have another minute to expand on that.
The UDC is an important document, but it's not a perfect document. And I think that's one area that we have to look to work hand in hand with developers so that we ultimately get the community that we would all love and cherish. It's not a perfect document. It's not one size fits all. Yes, should it be enforced? Absolutely, without doubt. Because developers will come in and they will push as hard as they possibly can push. And if we roll over to them, then, you know, so be it. Then we've done ourselves more harm than good. But what we need to do is learn to work with them hand in hand so that we do compromise in the right ways where the community gets to participate. And at the end, we're all better for it.
Mr. Bob? Does Forsyth County need more parks? And if so, what types?
I do not believe Forsyth for the foreseeable future needs any more parks. We barely got several of the ones open up. There will be, I think, three or four opening up between the end of this month and next month. They're all nice. In fact, some of them are incredibly nice. The county also has on the order of 600 acres of land that was that we're leasing from the Corps of Engineers for a very minimal sum, and by minimal I mean $1 or $10 a year or something like that. I don't know the exact amount, which we could use as parks if we so desired. But again, then if you open them up as parks, you got to have people to police them in one form or another and take care of the grounds and stuff. So I think we're pretty stocked up on parks at this point.
Mr. Drew?
I'm assuming the question means, do we currently need any more parks? And under that assumption, I would say no as well. I think the important thing that we need to do right now is to understand what the operating cost is behind these parks. As you all know, that the bond for the parks, that produced the parks, was for the construction of the parks and the initial cost. We still don't know what that's going to cost us in terms of utility expenses, personnel, maintenance, upkeep, repair, and I think we need to get our arms around that and then see where we can go from there.
Thank you, gentlemen. We appreciate that. Those were candid questions. We appreciate the candid responses. At this time, we will move to the closing area of our debate, and we'll let Mr. Drew lead off. You each have a minute and a half to make the closing statement.
First of all, I want to thank everybody coming out here tonight. I mean, it's really important to me. I know that it's important to Jim as well. Thank you for participating in your community. By the virtue of the fact that I'm sitting up here, you know that I'm here to ask you for your support. But one of the things that I find very interesting is I've participated in this process, and I've talked to a lot of people. I'm telling you, I walk door to door every weekend for hours and hours, and I'm amazed at what I get to inform people about who their district commissioner is, what does a commissioner do, when is early voting, why is July 31st so important. You think about it, in the last vote that we had in this county, 13,000 people, a little over 13,000 people voted. We have a community of over 175,000. So I'm not going to go on and on about accolades about me. What I would ask each of you to do is that when you leave here, whether you're going to vote for me or whether you're going to vote for Jim, it's important that you vote. I'm telling you that there are a lot of people, a lot of young men and women out there in horrible places having to do horrible things. Tell your friends to get out, get a hold of one of these candidates, no matter what district you're in. Thank them by voting. That's what I want to ask you tonight. Either you're here to vote for me or not. Thank you.
Yes, I also would appreciate your vote and any other considerations or thoughts that you might have. I think it's important to ask yourself, does the candidate I'm voting for have any experience, and does he have the time? I've been retired for a number of years now. Being a commissioner takes a lot of time. When I ran the first time, I attended nearly all work sessions and any other session that the commissioners had for a full year before the election. I think I've shown that I have the time, and in doing that and being commissioner for the last 4 years, I think I have demonstrated some amount of experience. But to help you remember to vote and who to vote for, I hold up my sign and say what I always say, best one for Forsyth, best one for five. Thank you very much.
Thank you both gentlemen. Everyone, we'll be taking a short break. We'll reconvene at 7:30 for the District 4 debate. Thank you.
This is the missus?
It is.
I'm sorry.
This is Bill Mulroney. This is Cindy Boff.
Nice to meet you, finally.
Nice to meet you, too.
All right. My arms are getting tired, guys. I gotta go.
All right.
Y'all have a good night.
There you go.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jack. I appreciate that. Yeah.
Don't forget, this one was laying on the ground right there.
You.
I didn't want you to forget it.
Oh, thank you.
No problem.
Best one for Forsyth.